Sit up.
Yeah, you look good. All right. Ready? Action.
Hey, everybody. I'm Robert Mason from the band Warrant, and you are all involved and invited to the Straus Project. Straus Project rolls on. We are at the Arcata Theater in St. Charles with Robert Mason of Warrant. Thanks for joining us today.
It's not the Manhattan
No.
It's the Straus Project.
It is the Straus Project, yes.
I sit corrected.
Thank you very much for joining us today. And
pleasure to be here.
You're no longer the new guy. You've actually been in Warrant now for almost 10 years.
In September, it's 10 years, yeah. Thank you for noticing.
That's awesome. And you have a very unique situation in that not only did you replace somebody that sang a bunch of songs that were written before you, but you were also friends with that person.
We were friends since I landed in L.A., was recording Lynch Mob record in the fall of 91. So, yeah. Summer, early fall of 91.
And then, speaking of Lynch Mob, you just did a stint recently where you were back. I mean,
how many bands is the guy in?
Yeah, let's talk about it. How many bands do you have working right now?
I don't know. It's technically three, sort of. If you want to, you know, you're in. George had asked me to do some Lynch Mob dates. I was available. Warrant's my priority. You understand that?
Of course.
He understands that. Hopefully the world understands that, because like the interwebs were going like, well, what band is he in? Don't worry about it. Do you know Corey Taylor? He's in a couple of bands. Miles Kennedy, also a friend of mine in a couple of bands. I'm in a band, you're in a band, so what?
And that's really cool, is that I feel like the attitude towards that has changed, at least over the years, in terms of doing side projects.
Agreed. It's funny. We've sat in more dressing rooms with more other bands, and they're like, you're looking around, we're all smiling and happy and like sharing beers, and you know, sometimes even dressing rooms after shows, it's like the difference is we're all smiling now. We were in the same situation years ago, and certain bands, there was always, I guess it was a little more, you're younger men, there's a little more, you know, piss and vinegar, testosterone and rivalry going on. Now I'm completely, once again, I'm in a band, you're in a band, cool, so what?
Right, and I feel like it's different now, right? Like you were saying before, there isn't as much ego involved. I feel everybody is a lot more appreciative of where they're at.
I think that's the thing. If you last long enough, you start to gain a greater appreciation for that, and that probably manifests itself in you just being a little more relaxed in your own skin, in your band's skin. You know, it's a nostalgia thing now for a lot of us. If you last long enough,
the older crowd,
right, you become a classic rock band, kids. Like, remember when Led Zeppelin was a classic rock band?
Oh, you.
What are they now?
Speaking of which, I feel like that there's this great connection with classic rock bands and metal. Like, some of the people that you say that influenced you, like Glenn Hughes.
Everybody.
Or
right.
Lou Gramm of Foreigner. You've got somebody like the lead singer of Hurricane taking the place of a classic rock band, and it's funny how that matures.
And Kelly does an amazing job doing that too.
Yeah, he sounds really great.
Yeah.
So where do you get your attitude? How do you get right with the validation of, hey, I deserve to be here, with, oh, I'm thankful for the opportunity?
It's a combination of both. It's a line. It's like the line between art and commerce. You know, you write a song, but you'd like it to be successful because you want people to hear it. Unless you want to be completely artsy and into yourself, and there's nothing wrong with that either. But I've always been the former. I've always been the guy who's like, you go see Kiss at Madison Square Garden when you're a kid like I did. You go see Van Halen. You go see the bands. And I remember hanging around with other musicians who would see that and go, I just want to quit. They're so good. Or I think that was a common thing growing up, like around me and guitar players.
Right. Oh, Eddie Van Halen's playing. I got to drop my guitar and throw it away.
I'm a closet guitar player, so I'm like super heavy handed, and it's cool to write songs. And piano was my first instrument, so guitar made sense to me in a melodic sense. I think everything is either every vocal line is either a guitar or a horn line. You know, orchestral.
Can we stay with the creative angle there for a second?
Yeah.
Because I know that you've always been into singing, and I read something where you were talking about the math of a song, and that really struck me in terms of the creative process.
I was an English major in college. I'm a poetry fan. There's iambic pentameter. I got trapped in that for a while. Early songwriting, writing in that, or writing in trochaic. Whatchamacallit. Just look it up, kids. YouTube it. Google it. You'll find it. So. To get away from that, then you discover songwriters that throw all those rules out and just go with the feel of something. Sometimes things just work out great and are pleasing to the ear, but when you think of them, you're like, I don't know whether this is going to work, and all of a sudden with the right riff and the right chordal thing, it comes together and makes an amazing song. The math of it, as far as just understanding music theory, I was taught it, and I ran away from it because being young and stupid in a sense, being a little rebellious kid, instead of reading my piano charts, I would learn them. And my ear was better than my want to straight read a chart like a session musician can.
Well, nobody likes to study.
Study schmuddy. I could play football outside instead and then go ride my skateboard or,
right,
draw pictures of motorcycles and hot rods.
So you picked everything up by ear.
My ear was much better, thankfully, than my want to learn theory. So I would learn a piece. I would go through the exercise learning it, but then I would have it in my head. I'd play it from memory, staring blankly at the sheets of music, and eventually my piano teacher was like, got hip to it. I was like, you're not reading. I said, yeah, I read it once, and I learned it. And even like an eight-year-old kid, I was that snotty. I just wanted to be a loud rock kid. I also didn't want to... Although I'm classically trained for a bunch of years, I didn't want to sing in Italian or German and wear a tux. I didn't want to sing opera. I didn't want to do that. I was always the rock kid, so I had opera teachers and coaches that would refuse to accept what I wanted to do and push me in a direction I didn't want to go, and I didn't go very long in that direction. It was like I always rebelled.
I think that's really interesting because you have to find the right creative people that will accept your idea of creativity. Sometimes that you can be creative and not jive with somebody else's level of creativity.
Yeah, are we getting too heavy? I don't know. But I did find a vocal teacher who had been accepted to Juilliard when she was like 15 or 16, like prodigally early. Her great grandfather was Fiorella LaGuardia.
Nice airport.
Nice, yeah. And a good politician. Once again, kids, look it up. Know your history. So she would just regurgitate all this stuff that she had learned. It's like getting one degree removed Juilliard training, and I was one of her brat students that wanted to be a rock kid. But she had done not only opera, not only USO shows, clubs, jazz houses in New York, that sort of thing. She had worn the shoes. She was the first traditional opera teacher, so to speak, who had pop sense and would be okay with what I wanted to do. So unbelievably, unendingly encouraging. And that's probably why I stuck with it and learned not to burn my throat out, and to do what I can do. So thankfully I can. So Gloria, thanks. Thanks, Gloria.
Burning your throat out. You do vocal exercises daily?
I warm up and warm down. No, I take long periods of rest. I've never babied my voice very much. But I know its limits and I know what it's capable of, in a sense that 90% of the time I can do it safely, whether or not it sounds like it, and I can recover and do the next one the next day, and the next one the next day, and the next one the next day. So,
well, I mean, that isn't taught, so how do you find out that you can do that? Obviously, going out there and doing it every night.
Research.
So,
yeah.
And that brings to the amount of work that you have and that you do. You seem like a guy that's working all the time. Project after project.
Like, I think of it as I retire one or two days a week. And then I go back to work. Like, I get home and obviously laundry, unpack, repack, that sort of thing. Enjoy the fruits of your labor somewhat. I have, fun hobbies. I have stuff I collect. I have stuff I'd like to do. But I'm really happiest, and it's just I sound so cheesy when I say this. It's honest to God truth. I'm on this side of a microphone, and people are on that side, and I get to do that. it's never been lost on me that I have a wonderful profession that I've lucked into, carved out for myself, figured out how to do, worked hard at enough. You know, the harder you work, the luckier you get.
So, absolutely.
But doing the thing, getting back with George, and doing the George, Mick, and Jeff and I, I'm about 3/4 of the way done with that record now. I go back in a couple of weeks to Jeff Pilson's house and try to finish. Then George asked me, well, you know, I got this room. If you, I got a couple of dates here. Do you want to do some Lynch Mob dates? Because we're getting along so well and writing and having such fun writing in the studio. It just, when it's the perfect storm of, we had Warrant shows on the East Coast, and then he wanted to do the Rock Cruise, the Warrant guys were flying home. I was like, I'll stay out for a week and I'll go do those shows. Same thing with, we had one full week off and I just did 4 in a row Lynch Mob on the Northeast Coast. So it, when it works out well.
And you said you were writing with George too?
We're doing a record, Jeff Pilson, Mick Brown, George and I.
Right. So then when you're doing that with them and then you're writing with the guys from Warrant, do you have a different mindset or a different approach?
Completely different.
How?
It's inspired by the music, whether or not I come up with something or any of the other guys in Warrant. It helps to shape the song. Sometimes I'll be in the shower and have a, you know, an idea. Thank God all these phones now are water resistant, because I've like run out of the shower, thrown it in record and whistled or hummed or whatever, you know, screamed into it. But a riff that George writes or a thing that George and Jeff will come up with musically, that's the way that that record has come about. I've let them just overwrite. And then whatever parts of it give me a lyrical or melodic idea, then Jeff and I get in his studio and play cut and paste in the digital realm. I was like, okay, this part's awesome. I have a thing for it. It should repeat, but you made it 10 times too long. Can we chop it up? That's, and they're super amenable to that, and that's how that record has been done.
That's changed a little bit since when you started in the business, huh?
Oh, God, yeah.
The way you make a record.
Stand in a room
at
ear-bleeding levels and, like, you know, amps so loud it'll make you sterile, and you're sitting there and they're, what? No, I like this. And then you scream. Like, the way I got the Lynch Mob gig is they played demos on my audition. I sang a bunch of stuff off of Wicked, a couple of Dawkins songs, a couple of Led Zeppelin songs, a couple of whatever. And then George's wheels are turning. He's smiling, and he had them run DAT tapes at the time, I think, and played me every demo of every song. He played me live. The band played instrumentally, and I just sang scattered over them. And they recorded all that at my audition. 2 weeks later, I'm in the band, and a lot of my first inspiration melody stuff or a word here, or like you singing, you know, phrase only, phonetically, whatever vowel sound feels like it works great. That, to me, became the bed of everything that we wrote together for that Lynch Mob record in 92. Like, at my audition. So that's the way we used to do it. Banging out in a loud room. Now you can do it, you know, in separate continents via email.
Yeah, and
it's lost a little.
The role of the record company has changed too, right?
Well, the role of everything has changed.
And then
everything.
And like your relationship with the fans, the things that you have to do now that you weren't doing before. Like, do you feel like
all their videos and respond to all their...
Well, yeah, I think you have to be more accessible. I think that's all part of it, right?
Yeah.
With the advent of social media, everyone's a critic. And if somebody says, hey, I saw Robert Mason and he was a jerk, and all of a sudden somebody shares it and then somebody else shares it. Now all of a sudden...
And now everybody is... We were just talking about that back in that time, you know, the time before smartphones or whatever and social media. You would say it to 5 or 10 of your buddies, or you would talk about a show. Or the good thing is you'd talk about a show and give everybody a glowing review at the water cooler on Monday morning with a hangover about how great the concert was.
Right.
Now, all you do is type and hit send, virtually or not, and whatever your opinion is, valid or not, and I think it's given everybody a little bit of an overinflated sense of self in some ways. It has. Let's fess up. Let's be honest. But the good is the good, the bad is the bad. It's just almost been inflated.
Amplified. Everyone's got something to say, and some people scream it.
And right, exactly. And, you know, anger on your keyboard is like, if you're going to hate on me, I've said it before and I'll say it again. Come out to a show, tell me in person. If you like it, great. If you don't like it, great. Let's have a conversation about it.
Yeah, there are a lot of keyboard warriors out there, people who would never, ever say things like that to your face.
Of course, and it's given people a certain amount of protection and anonymity that obviously, everybody's talked about this. I'm not, you know, this is not groundbreaking conversation, but it's real and you feel it. You just have to become... I was really thick-skinned beforehand. Like I said, once again, I'm in a band, you're in a band, so what? that should be the theme of this entire conversation. I like the bands I'm in. I like the music I make. I like some of the music you make. Let's all rock out and get along.
Well, I think it shows every night on stage, and we really appreciate you taking the time.
I really try, honestly. Once again, I'm super thankful. I think I say it every night if I don't forget. You know, like, hey, sing all the right words if you can and make up witty shit to say too, you know, and like on the fly and change it up every night. It's not stock. Although some of the heckler stuff is stock. The heckler response stuff when I do that, because I learned from like David Lee Roth and people like that who were just stand-up comics that were just the absolute best at just every heckler that comes up.
It's amazing how passionate some people can be in their
Can I take a sip?
Of course. Okay. It's funny. Just some people will scream something at you, and then you look at them because you heard them, and then they kind of cower away like, oh, I didn't mean for you to hear that.
Right. Well, why'd you say it?
Right.
Jack? You know?
I don't get it.
Right.
So it does. It looks like a lot of fun on stage every night, and you look like you appreciate where you are and what you're doing. And
I really do.
And just the road that you've taken to get here, we're really excited about seeing you tonight. So thank you so much for taking the time.
Yeah, I got a motor.
We got to get you out of here.
Okay.
It's the Straus Project from the Arcata Theater in St. Charles with Robert Mason.
Thank you.